called me the girlfriend. I thought his love was divine. But now he's found another girlfriend in the house next door to mine. He used to like my kisses. He always wanted more. But now when he wants kisses, he gets them from the girl next door.
Things, faces, friends, places. Years and moments half forgotten. Laughs, fears, songs, tears. Memories are made of this. I remember a time, the first of the 30s, when we were happy when we were hiking. Gone the post-war indecisive turmoil of the 20s. With the new era, we'd go marching forward in peace and reason towards a reasonably rosy future. The first of the 30s, a time of optimism, vague and woolly perhaps, but still optimism. A new look to those who go up and down in the park, dress less formal, but still the same stable old Britain. No Cold War, no hydrogen bombs, and though the world might be well and truly in the economic doldrums, it was still a pretty wonderful place, especially when you were young. A new look to the streets, the cars, the buses, as though we were all out to rub away the rough shapes and edges of the 20s, all out to streamline our world for the future. First, the new broom would sweep for peace. In London, the leaders of seven major powers were meeting to discuss international stability and disarmament. Ramsay MacDonald for Britain, Monsieur Laval and Monsieur Briand for France, Grandi for Italy, Stimson for the United States, and many others. We even had a Germany in the League of Nations. An air of real trying, as though at last all were united in realization of war's absurdity. Streamlining for peace. Into a British port there sailed someone whose garb and demeanor made him the most publicized figure of the age. A roundtable conference had been called in London to settle in peace the thorny problems of India and her demands for self-determination. So there appeared in London the living symbol of countless millions, Mahatma Gandhi. To a few in the park, no doubt this appearance on their doorstep of such a rebel must have caused many mutterings. And on the other side of the selfsame park, something else for them to mutter about. The hunger marchers. 200,000 unemployed, escorting a petition signed by a million persons. A demand for the abolition of the means test. A demand for someone, somewhere, to do something about empty coal trucks and the resultant empty stomachs. In Downing Street and other political circles, restlessness called for a demand for concerted action. The socialist administration fell, to be followed by a ministry of all the talents, a coalition. They called it a national government, though whether it was more national than any other was a matter for discussion. What exactly a national government was up to Mr. Baldwin to explain.
National government is a great idea. There is nothing petty in our outlook on this situation, and I believe we shall have it in our power to do not only a great work of reconstruction for our own country, but a work of international reconciliation supported by the mandate of a united people.